next song is a little bit of a new twist on an old classic. So we'll sit down once for you. Go ahead.
Gold stars of Christianity for today, for braving the weather and the Chiefs traffic to make it here on time. I'm going to be sharing with you this morning a little bit as we continue in our series, Created for Christmas. And as you can tell, we're going to do things a little bit out of order today. So we're going to be doing some singing throughout the worship service this morning. And I was thinking, is there a song that puts you in the Christmas mood? What is one of those songs that just, you're like, wow, if I hear that song, I'm instantly transported to the Christmas spirit. And I was thinking about that. My sister gave me the Nat King Cole album on vinyl last year. And that is required listening when we're putting up the Christmas tree in the Shell household, right? Because that's instant Christmas spirit. And so it's kind of fun to think about, what would that be? What would it be like to think? What puts us in the mood? And my job is such that I get to listen to Christmas music in June, which is a bit of an issue on our staff. It's caused some controversy because you can hear stuff that I play in my office and other people's offices, and I tend to listen to music loudly. And so about June, some folks start knocking on the door, calling me, going, what are you doing? It's not Christmas. And so that's kind of one of the opportunities I get. So this morning, I thought, before we jump right in, I'm going to ask Mika, where'd you go? Where'd she go? To come back up, and we're going to have her sing one of our favorite Christmas songs.
Yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. From now on, our troubles will be out of sight.
So that's the first or second track on our album next year, right? Okay. Sounds good. So already in this season, we've looked at two important parts of about what it means to be created for Christmas. The first week, Jeff shared with us what it means to be blessed to be a blessing, realizing that we don't just exist for ourselves, and that God put us here to be a blessing to others, and that God wants generosity, something that he wants for us. And last week, Jim Lee got up and he shared about being created for community, realizing we were created to be with other people, something that we typically do around the holiday season. And if you remember last week, he said, victory is what, if you were here? The victory is Jesus. That is the universal answer, by the way, to any Sunday school question, right? So Jim Lee shared last week that the victory is Jesus, and I love that he did that because it's a great segue to talk about worship this week. It's interesting to think that the wise men, when they arrived and showed up to see the baby Jesus, their reaction was worship. So the victory of getting to be there with Jesus was worship. And that's what we're talking about today, being wired for worship. And you guys, as you walk around and you shop and you go various places, this is one of the few times in the year that is acceptable for people who can't even sing that just walk around singing out loud, right? And this is also one of those interesting times of year where you go into stores and you hear worship music. You hear music about Jesus. I was thinking about some of the albums I have, hearing guys like Frank Sinatra sing about Jesus. I mean, that's a little ironic. And one of the arrangements that we did this morning, Jesus, What a Wonderful Child, there's quite a few artists that have covered that that normally would not have anything to do with the Lord. And yet, at Christmas time, it's acceptable. So God wired you for worship, and you will worship something or someone. So who or what is that this morning? If you would, grab your Bibles. Let's go to Luke chapter 2. We're going to read kind of the latter half of the Christmas story. So this is Luke 2. We're going to start in verse 8. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste, and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning the child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. Now, up on the screen is going to be a quote from Ralph Waldo Emerson. I'd like for us to look at that quote together. It says, A person will worship something. Have no doubt about that. We may think our tribute is paid in secret in the dark recesses of our hearts, but it will come out. That which dominates our imaginations and our thoughts will determine our lives and our character. Therefore, it behooves us to be careful what we worship. For what we are worshiping, we are becoming. Now, I think all of us realize today that worship is so much more than just music. It's so much more than just what we sing. You hear a lot of times in churches that worship is a lifestyle, and truly it is. It is a lifestyle that we devote completely and solely to God. I would imagine that many of us in this room can think of people that maybe we know who are obsessed with something other than the Lord. They're obsessed with maybe money or fame or power. Maybe their object of worship is their family. Maybe their object of worship is their kids or their job. But we truly all will worship something. We were talking about this sermon on Monday, and Brian had shared an interesting example. When we were younger, well, at least when I was younger, I can remember times, you know, you go out and you play sports, and you would want to emulate the sports star. Now, he referenced basketball, which I don't understand. I'm not a basketball player. I'm terrible at basketball. But he's like, you know, I'd be out there shooting hoops, and I'd shoot the ball, and I'd yell, Kobe, as I would shoot. See, growing up for me, it was like, ooh, look at me. I'm going to be just like Vladimir Horowitz. Five of you know who that is, and they're all in my family. Or I'm going to play the cello like Yo-Yo Ma. What that is worship. We're standing at the plate, and we're like, I'm going to hit this ball like George Brett would hit it. It's worship. We're kind of worshiping them. We're emulating them. We're wanting to be just like they are. Think about it. There are entire TV series devoted to worshiping people. And they're train wrecks, and we love watching them, don't we? That's worship. That's what that is. But what stands out to me in the Luke passage is one of the statements the angel makes. And the angel said unto them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." So this morning, I said, we're going to sing a little bit. So we're going to sing just a verse and chorus of "Hark the Herald Angels Sing." We'll have Jenny get us started. Just sing with us.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. Angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Great, you all can grab a seat. As you're grabbing a seat, open your Bibles again. Let's look at Psalm 96. We're going to look at the first three verses in Psalm 96. Psalm 96 says, "Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. Sing unto the Lord, bless his name. Show forth his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the heathen," or we would say the nations. "His wonders," or we would say his marvelous works, "among all the people." I bring us there because the angels were proclaiming the good news of the gospel. Jesus had come to earth. The word "good tidings" in your New Testament actually is where we get the word evangelism from. So the angels were coming and they were evangelizing. When you choose to worship God, to make him the first focus of your life, you proclaim his gospel message to the rest of the world through your life. So, who or what are you worshiping this morning? Now, we were created to give God glory. There's a verse in Revelation that describes this idea, and it says, "For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created." Our very bodies were designed and wired with worship in mind. Our voices can bring God praise. Not again, not just in singing, but in speaking, in the things that we say. Our bodies are designed for praise. There are many worshipful actions in Scripture. There's bowing, there's kneeling, praying, clapping, dancing, for a few of you. And we are body, soul, and spirit. And each of these connect together to praise God, meaning we can connect our intellect with our heart. John 4:23. "But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him." I hear people say all the time, you know, the animals proclaim God's glory because when a bird sings, it's praising God. Yeah, that's true, but we get the luxury of being able to connect that intellectually and saying, look, not only am I going to praise God because he is God, but because I want to. And because he's God, and because I love him, and because he loves me. And you carry the message of what you worship with you. Okay, so let's take a snapshot of the last 7 days of your life. What would it say you worship? This is the time of year, right, on Facebook, all the apps. Like, here are the words that you have most used on Facebook this year. If we were to look at that, what would Facebook say to all your friends? Here's what Jeremy worships. So if you're a parent in the room, who would your kids say that you worship? If you're a student, who would your classmates say you worship? Or your parents? What about your coworkers? We just took a snapshot and say, what does your life reflect? What would it say that this is who or what I worship? So then we have to ask the question, well, what is worship?
Worship is our human response to what God has done, what he is doing, and what he will do. And we see examples all throughout Scripture of people responding to God in worship. Okay, so before the Exodus, we have the moment, right, where God speaks to Moses at the burning bush. And he sends Moses and Aaron, and they're going to go talk to the nation of Israel, and they're going to say, look, we're going to show you some signs, we're going to proclaim some things, and God is going to set us free from the nation of Egypt. Exodus 4:31 says, after they heard this, and the people believed, and when they had heard that the Lord visited the children of Israel, and that he looked upon their affliction, then they bowed their heads and worshiped. They were responding to what God has done. Think about what happened after the Exodus, right? So they get out of Egypt. The first thing they do is have an incredible worship service. I mean, they pull out all the stops. They sing and they proclaim the goodness of God in response to what he has done. If we fast forward a little bit and look at Nehemiah, right? So after hearing the word of God read, so, and they stood up in their place and they read in the book of the law of the Lord their God 1/4 part of the day, and another 1/4 part they confessed and worshiped the Lord their God. They hadn't heard the word, and all of a sudden they did. And they stood and they listened to God's word, and then they responded to it in worship. How do you respond to God? Do you respond to God in worship? We know in Scripture that we are commanded to worship and to give glory to God. 1 Chronicles 16:29 says, give unto the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. And I wish we had the time this morning to break down, because I love that phrase, the beauty of holiness. But what an incredible way for us to worship God. Finally, worship is the ultimate goal. So the verse I read to you earlier out of Revelation, here's the whole verse. This is Revelation 4:11. It says, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. God wired us so that we would worship him in the end. So I'm going to have you stand again. We're going to sing a little bit of Revelation song. What an appropriate song this morning, just to continue in our atmosphere of worship.
Praise to the King of Kings. You are.
once again. Amen. Just stay standing because we're going to sing just a chorus of another Christmas carol in just a minute. I want to start off by saying this before we go to that. As we think about what we can learn about worshiping God, is the first thing we want to talk about is putting God first. And suddenly there was with an angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest." So here's another older Christmas carol. This is Angels from the Realms of Glory. So let's sing that together as well. Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight o'er all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. So number one, put God first. Again, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest." Do you notice that the angels proclaimed God's glory first? I'm a dad, I'm a husband, and there's nothing that I wouldn't do to stand in the way of protecting my family, right? I would give up my life for my family. I know a lot of you feel the same way as parents or as grandparents, but there's nothing that would get in the way of that. But God says that He wants us to put Him first. Deuteronomy 6:5 says, "And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might." So are you telling me to put God above everything? Yes. Are you telling me to put God above my job? Yes. God above my family? Yes. Why? Because if you will do that, if God is first, you will love your family so much the more. If you put God first, your relationships will be better. If you put God first, your boss will think differently of you. All of a sudden, something will be new and different. You want to be a worshiper of God, you put God first. Number two, trust and obey Him. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, "Let us now go." And then later it says, "And they came with haste." I think this is interesting. If you were here the first week, Jeff pointed out that the religious rulers didn't bother to check out whether or not the Bethlehem story was true. They didn't bother to go and see, has this really happened? Do you notice the contrast to the shepherds here? The shepherds, what does the Bible say, went with haste. That means they went quickly. They said, "Let us now go." The shepherds immediately went to see what the angels had told them. Worshippers of God, if you want to be a worshiper of God, you got to trust God and obey him to whatever end. Another one of our verses, Romans 12:1-2 says, I beseech you, or I beg you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The shepherds went immediately. God said, I need you to go, and they went. Not only did their response include them going and seeing the Messiah, it included them sharing God's story with others. Will you look in the next two verses, or in verses 17 and 18 in the book of Luke? It says, and when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning the child. And all they that heard it wondered or marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. So the shepherds did just exactly what the angels did. The shepherds were evangelized by the angels, and then the shepherds went out and told others about what they had seen. And as worshipers, we need to trust God that he will lead us on the right path and then obey him. So God called you to be a worshiper. So that's first. No, God called me to be a teacher. No, God called you to be a worshiper. If you're a teacher, be a worshiper as a teacher. If God called you to be a pipe fitter or an iron worker, you're a worshiper first. If God called you to be a stay-at-home mom, you're a worshiper first. I love asking this question of my students at Calvary. I'll say, so when you get your degree, what are you going to do with it? What are you going to do with your degree? What are you going to do when you get all grown up? I don't know. I'm going to graduate in 2 weeks. I have no idea what I'm going to do with my life. That's awesome. Be a worshiper wherever God puts you. That's the first step. Now, in our worship services each week, we take a few minutes and we spend a little bit of time in prayer. So I'm going to call all of us to do that right now. So we're not done, so this is not your cue to leave. Right, we're not going to lock the doors on you, though. But I want you to hang out with us a little bit, because I want to call us all to a time of prayer. First and foremost, I want you to just take a minute. I want you to pray that God would reveal what is first in your life. Is there something ahead of God right now? And then I want you to pray that God would help you to put him first. Maybe you've done that. Maybe God is first. Would you pray for God to help you to trust him? Or maybe this morning it's a point of obedience. God, I need you to help me to obey, to move forward. Now, we're going to open up the front. So if you'd like to come forward, we're going to sing a song for you, by the way. I want you guys to just stay seated unless you'd like to come forward and pray. Unless you'd like to take in the Lord's table this morning, maybe something that you need to remember. So let's take a little bit of time. I'd like you to just go to prayer, reflect on those things, ask God to reveal to you again what's first, or maybe this is a time that I need to trust him and obey him. So please, if you need to, come forward.
A child is born.
So, first and foremost, we put God first. Secondly, trust and obey Him. Third, live a life filled with thanksgiving and praise. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen as it was told unto them. You want an easy place to start? We'll see you here Sunday mornings, 9 o'clock, 10:45, on time, right here in this room. That is exactly what we do in the first 20, 25 minutes of our worship services, is we just proclaim God's goodness, and we thank Him for what He's done. It's just a great opportunity to just come and to worship Him and to say, thank you, Lord, for all the things that you've done this week. It's not just a churchy tradition, right? It's not just something we do to just quickly save time so that we can make sure that everybody's in the room by the time, you know, the pastor gets up. No, it's an opportunity for us to respond to God in worship. Does your daily conversation reflect a life of thanksgiving and praise? In this last month, we have spent more money on our two cars than two people should ever spend on vehicles. It's been completely crazy. And I can remember when I was picking my car up, and I'm riding with my dad, and he said, "We were so thankful that you weren't hurt, because my I don't even know how this happens, but the steering broke in half." That's what the mechanic told me. He said, "Your steering was broken in half." I don't even know how that works. But my response had to be different from just anger and frustration. What I need to do is say, thank you, Lord, for protecting me so I didn't wreck my car. And that's a harder, greater life lesson to learn in being thankful. And that does not compare to some of the things that I'm sure some of you are experiencing. Someone who was on our praise team just lost her husband. And it's hard at that point to go, how do I remain grateful? Or how do I give God glory in those moments? But God calls us in those times to still bring him praise. God calls us when our life is at its lowest to still bring him praise. Because if we'll do that when our life is at its peak, we will still bring him praise. And we see the example that we get in Scripture of our shepherds. Verse in Revelation 7:12 says, saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen. You want to be a worshiper? Put God first. Trust him, obey him, and then live a life that's filled with thanksgiving and praise. I love a statement as we were talking in our sermon prep meeting that we said that this is the time of year that we really try to be the people that we want to be the rest of the year. So we're a little extra generous. We get together with our families and have community, and we sing like we've done this morning. But can I encourage you, as we get closer to January 1st and we think, New Year's resolution, I'm going to be this next year. Could we be these three things? We want to challenge you here to go out and be a blessing to other people. I was thinking, what are some of the stories that maybe are in the room today about people who, after that first week, said, I'm going to go and do that. I'm going to go and I'm going to be generous to somebody who maybe I'm not normally generous to. So would you pray that God would lay that on your heart to be a blessing to someone else? Being created for community, opening up your house or your heart to other people. This is not a season and not a time for you to go and hide. God designed you to be with other people. So would you do that? Would you go, okay, I'm not going to hide this Christmas season. I'm not going to hide next year. I'm going to open myself up. Maybe it's getting involved in a small group here at our church. Or maybe it's doing directions in the smaller format that we're doing. Maybe it's getting on a serving team where you're going to get to know other people. Maybe it's just you reaching out to your neighbor or to your coworker. Or maybe your kids or your parents and going, let's create or let's have community together. And then remembering that you were wired to worship God. So the desire of our hearts this year is, I'm going to put God first. I'm going to trust him. I'm going to obey him. And then I'm going to be thankful, and I'm going to give God praise in everything. Let's pray together. Father, we are so thankful that we get to sing and rejoice about the things that you did. Lord, the fact that you came to earth as a baby, God, that you came in such an incredibly humble way. But Lord, you came as a king. And the least of them, God, the shepherds, were the first worshipers. So Lord, this morning I pray that you would help us to remember the things we've covered, God, that you have created us to be a blessing for other people, Lord, that you have created us to be in community, and God, you have wired us to worship you, and God, I pray that our hearts would be motivated this week to that. Lord, if there's somebody here who doesn't get it, who says, I'm not entirely sure what it means to be a worshiper, I pray that you this morning would motivate their heart, God, to grab someone they're sitting next to or come see one of us and just ask what it means to be a worshiper. Who is Jesus really and what does he mean to my life? For the rest of us, God, give us big eyes and ears to see where you want us to be and motivate our hearts, Lord, to continue to serve and worship you and to bring you the glory. In Jesus' name we pray this morning. Amen.
Amen. Man, thank you guys so much for coming out with us today. I know it's your toes starting to defrost a little bit. just in time to get back out there, right? Hopefully none of you are crazy enough to go to the Chiefs game today. Is there anybody that crazy today? Awesome. Total silence is what I expected there. So, you know, this is the first time we've really gone down to this one service. Just as a reminder, if you want updates on when that's going to happen, you can check our Facebook page. You can check our main site. We'll put it up in the banner straight top when you first hit the page, all right? So we'll try to get that word out to you as quickly as we have the information so we can make sure you know. And it's a good trial for the next couple of weeks, right? So I don't know if you guys are aware of this, but 7 days until Christmas, right? So, gentlemen, if you haven't started shopping, I would highly suggest you go ahead and get started. Now is the ideal time. Amazon Prime, 2-day shipping is your friend. But that doesn't mean you can wait till Thursday, okay? You need to start now. I say it's kind of a trial run because next weekend, because it's Christmas, we will have one service on Christmas Day at 10:45, okay? So it's going to be just kind of like today, okay? One service, 10:45. But the night before, on Christmas Eve, we'll have our Christmas Eve service, and that's going to be at 4 p.m., okay? So we'd love to see you guys out here. It's going to be an absolute blast. I know they've done a ton of work planning it and preparing exactly how it's going to go. We would love to have you out with us on Christmas Eve. So, again, Christmas Day, 10:45, okay? There are no classes that day. Nothing. Nada. It's all canceled. Just the main service at 10:45. And then, again, we're still practicing because then the next Sunday is New Year's Day, okay? This is that weird year where all the major holidays fall on a Sunday. So on New Year's Day, we will also only have one service. But don't sleep in, all right? Don't sleep in. I know you're up late. But get up early. Come out and join us because at 9 o'clock, the staff is going to be serving you breakfast. Okay, we're going to do a continental breakfast. We'll have a ton of stuff out there. Just come on out and join us at 9, and we'll just relax that morning, and then we'll start the service at 10:45, okay? So Sky Kids will open that morning, not for the non-existent 9 o'clock service, but they will open for the 10:45 service, all right? So you guys have a fantastic Christmas. I am going to have the ushers come forward. We're going to go ahead and take the offering. If you're crazy enough to be a first-time guest today, And this was the day that you ventured out in the snow to come visit us. First of all, praise God for you. You're awesome. You're also a little crazy, but I'm cool with that. But if you are, we would love a chance to meet you. There is a Connect card in the seat in front of you. We'd love for you to fill that out. Even if you've been here 10 years, if you have questions or you need prayer or you're ready to make that next step in your spiritual walk, I encourage you to fill that out. You can drop that in the buckets. You can put that in the there's a little card holder box. That's what they call them. They call them boxes. In the back of the room, you can drop it in. Or come by Guest Central. If you're a guest, come back there, fill out the Connect card. We've got a gift for you today. It's just our way of saying thank you for joining us. All right? We're going to go ahead and pray for the offering, and we'll get out of here. And stay warm today. All right? Father, I love you. Lord, I thank you so much for today. I thank you for this time that we could come together, that we could worship you. Lord, you are the one who has redeemed us, who has saved us, and given us freedom from our sin. And Lord, you are worthy of every second of our life being praised to you. And Lord, I ask now that you would take this offering, Lord, that you would just use it to reach those that don't know you, Lord, that you would give us the resources and the means and the heart and the desire, Lord, to love our neighbor. Lord, to care for those around us, and Lord, out of that they would see you. Father, we pray that you would be glorified in the process. And Father, we thank you that as we prepare to celebrate the birth of Jesus on earth, Lord, that every day we can rejoice in the truth of the forgiveness that you gave us. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. As the ushers take the offering, we're going to do a couple of songs this morning. So we're going to start with "O Come All Ye Faithful," and then we'll do one more kind of upbeat, fun one. So as the buckets pass, feel free to stand.
Come, O come, to pray.
Let's go back and sing the song we started this morning off, Jesus, What a Wonderful Child.